raise a mighty score to
and theme dinners. So look out for two of our big events this semester, which will be our annual culture crawl and a lecture with the head chef at Spoke in Davis Square.
Tufts Hillel Alumni Association helps build communities among Jumbo alums and keeps us connected to the important work that Hillel does on campus. We organize events for alumni involved with Hillel and Jewish life across the country, including neighborhood Shabbats, apple picking, Hanukkah parties, educational workshops, and more. So if you have ideas or want to get involved, please come find me after the show.
So you may not realize this, but it's actually pretty rare for students and alumni to work together to put on an event. So tonight is one of those rare occasions, and we're really excited to have both current and former Jumbos under one roof. So we hope that this will be a great model for engaging students and alumni in the future. And if you're not part of the Tufts community, welcome to campus, and we hope you have a great evening.
We also want to thank our partners, the Tufts Alumni Boston and the Tufts Podcast Network. Thank you to everyone for coming. We hope you enjoy the evening with Dan and all of his guests.
But first, to kick things off, what would a Tufts event be without the Bubs?
Bye. but I love it. No, I can't feel my face when I'm with you. But I love it. But I love it. Come on. I can't feel my face when I'm with you. But I love it. But I love it. But I love it. I can't feel my face when I'm with you. But I love it.
It is our great pleasure to introduce host of the Sporkful Tufts alum, Dan Pashman!
Big hand for the Tufts Beelzebubs, ladies and gentlemen. The Bubs have a new album out called In the Book. It's available on Spotify. Go check it out. One more time for the Bubs, please. That was awesome. Well, thank you guys so much for coming out. It's really exciting to be doing the Sporkful here at Tufts, at Cohen Auditorium, where I was in the audience for so many shows when I was a student here. I was reading recently about this thing called the reminiscence bump, which it's about brain development. Basically, it says that between the ages of 10 and 30, or 25 or 30, you have your brain encodes more memories at that age than at any other age, which is why you have really vivid memories of your teen years and your early 20s more so than other parts of your life. Like, you're not gonna remember your 30s at all. And it peaks like right at age 20, you know, right when you're in college. And so it has been amazing. I have not been back on campus for a long time, and I'm like walking around the campus, and you just come around a corner, and you just get hit by this wave of memories and nostalgia and sometimes of totally inconsequential things, but it's still very powerful, a powerful thing to experience. So it's exciting to be back here. So thank you. I thought I would, if you'll indulge me, reminisce, since I'm talking about the reminiscence bump. I'm going to reminisce for a couple minutes. And, you know, my radio career started here at Tufts. I started, as Marissa mentioned, I hosted a show here called, my friend Gabe and I hosted a show called After Hours with G-Money and the Pashman. We were kind of low on the totem pole at the radio station, so we got the only slot they had, which was 2 a.m. to 4 a.m., Thursday nights into Friday mornings. But we turned it into an opportunity. We made these postcards to promote the show, and we would go out to the bars and the parties on Thursday night and hand out postcards. And then people would go home to the dorms or to their apartments, order pizza, whatever else they were going to do, they'd turn on the show. And I can't tell you that it was a great show. Friends, I'm going to be honest, but we made a lot of great memories, and I actually went through some of the cassette tapes that I still have and pulled a few clips to share with you right now, just to hear what an imperfect show it was. First, I just wanted to play you some of our less flattering moments on After Hours with G-Money and the Pashman. Let's hear that.
This is 91.5 FM WMFO. Is that a good radio voice? I'm trying to work on my radio voice.
And we will be taking the third caller.
Right, the third caller, unless we get fewer than three callers.
Then we will take the last caller that calls under three.
Well, we had a small little technical difficulty there in our intro. What happened was I forgot to turn the mics on.
Yeah, I noticed.
But, you know, we're still learning.
Yeah, so, you know, we were learning. Oh, thanks, yeah. And one of the other fun things that we did is I got notable campus personalities to record IDs for our show. And this involved actually having a portable tape recorder. It's funny, I got interviewed for the Tufts Daily, and they said, oh, did you have a podcast when you were at Tufts? Right, yeah, thank you for getting that joke. And I had this tape recorder, and I would get notable campus personalities to record IDs. So things like this.
Hi, this is John DiBiagio, president of Tufts, and you're listening to the two guys that make $30,000 a year a reasonable price. After Hours with G-Money and the Pashman, 91.5 FM, WMFO, Jumbo Radio.
Yeah, we even got Rabbi Summit in the act. Hear this one.
Hi, this is Rabbi Jeffrey Summit of Tufts University. You're listening to the only two guys who make crossing the desert with nothing but matzah a good time. After Hours with G-Money and the Pashman, 91.5 FM, WMFO, Jumbo Radio.
Big hand for the rabbi. And one of my favorites of those IDs was, you guys know Bela Fleck and the Flecktones? They performed here on this very stage, February 21st, 1999. I remember that date because I had the bootleg tape because I was cool. And after the show, you could meet them right up here. And so I came up and I met Jeff Coffin, who's the horn player. Now he's the horn player for Dave Matthews Band, but he plays every kind of horn there is. Now keep in mind that my co-host on the radio show Tufts, his name was Gabe. And right here, we got Jeff Coffin to record this ID for us.
Hey, this is Jeff Coffin, baritone, tenor, alto, and soprano saxophonist, and flutist, or flautist, for Bela Fleck and the Flecktones. And if you think I spend a lot of time blowing, you should meet Gabe's mom. Stay tuned to After Hours with G-Money and the Pashman, 91.5 FM, WMFO Jumbo Radio.
It was college radio, okay? Cut me some slack. But, you know, from Tufts, I went on to work with Robin Young, who's now at WBUR. I helped launch Air America Radio, worked with Al Franken and Rachel Maddow, Janine Garofalo, Mark Maron. I got to help create and launch a show at NPR. And I had some amazing career experiences. Unfortunately, a lot of them ended with me getting laid off. Just, you know, well, a variety of reasons. And at a certain point, I was tired of that happening. I was inspired to start a podcast, because I figured if I own my own podcast, at least no one can cancel it but me. So I started this Sporkful, and I felt like I'd never done anything in food, but I had this idea of I can just talk about the most basic foods in the most ridiculous detail that might be entertaining to some people. And it turned out it was, and it's led to all these great opportunities, getting picked up at WNYC, doing a book, doing a web series for Cooking Channel that is now going to be a TV show on Cooking Channel. So I hope you'll tune in this Friday night at 9:30 for You're Eating It Wrong on Cooking Channel. We made one episode, and if enough of you watch it, we'll get to make a second episode. But you know, it's great to be here at Tufts and doing the food thing, because so many of my food memories are here at Tufts. So many of my formative memories. I remember my first time going to Tufts Hillel, I was lured by the bagels and lox. And the lox were like day glow orange. I called my mom, I was like, Mom, I don't know what the hell is going on here. These are not the lox I'm accustomed to. But it was a nice event anyway. My friend Matt made a sandwich in the Commons that he put potato chips in. First time I ever saw someone put potato chips in a sandwich. I remember a chicken nugget eating contest in the dining hall. I was the champ. I ate 45 chicken nuggets in one sitting. Not proud of that. Well, I'm a little bit proud. But I think my two best food memories from Tufts, one was going home late at night from parties, and I get up to the top of the hill in front of Olden Hall. There on the sidewalk, it's like 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning, but sitting in the middle of the sidewalk is a giant pile of cookies. And I was with my friend Mike, and I'm like, Mike! Eureka! And Mike's like, you are not going to eat cookies off of the ground. And I said, no, of course I'm not going to eat cookies off the ground. I'm going to eat cookies off of cookies. So I only ate the cookies that were touching other cookies, and they were delicious. Then there was a time homecoming weekend. There was some big alumni event on Fletcher Field, and I was walking home by there, and the whole thing had been cleaned up, except they left one giant grill. Like dining services left an industrial size, like grill on wheels. So I did what any quick-thinking college student did. I wheeled it back to my apartment. And the next morning, I wheeled it to the football field. And we had the biggest tailgate party that Tufts has ever seen. So I want to take a moment to thank Dining Services. Yeah, give a big hand. Big hand for Dining Services. I want to thank them for leaving things all over campus, because they really provided some of my most treasured memories. All right, well, thank you again for coming out. Are you guys ready to start this show? Let me get a quick sip of water. Here's how this is going to work. I'm going to say, this is the Sporkful. I'm going to say, from WNYC, this is the Sporkful. It's not for foodies, it's for eaters. I'm Dan Pashman, and we're coming to you live from Tufts University. We'll go with Medford, because that's where the post office is, in Medford, Massachusetts. And at that point, you guys go berserk, okay? Now, I could do the whole, like, are you ready? And you guys give, like, a half-hearted applause, and I say, like, that's not good enough. Ooh, oh boy. We're not going to do that here, because I have confidence in the jumbo audience. I have confidence in my Sporkful listeners that this is a one-take audience. So we're just going to do it, and you're going to go berserk on the first chance you get. Are you guys ready? Oh, crap, we weren't supposed to do that. All right, well, that was pretty good anyway. Are we recording? All right, young kids getting into radio, press record. From WNYC, this is the Sporkful. It's not for foodies, it's for eaters. I'm Dan Pashman, and we're coming to you live from Tufts University in Medford, Massachusetts. That was excellent. That's what I call a jumbo welcome. It is great to be here on the campus of Tufts University, my alma mater, where I graduated in 1999. We are the Tufts University Jumbos, for those of you who don't know. Our mascot is Jumbo the Elephant. And you know, Jumbo was a real elephant, a legendary elephant. And I know that the folks here from the Tufts community know the gist of the story, but I gotta be honest, I don't think that people at Tufts appreciate just what an awesome mascot Jumbo the Elephant is. Jumbo was the first African elephant ever made it alive to Europe. He was a sensation in the London Zoo, and in around 1875, 1880, Winston Churchill rode on Jumbo the Elephant, among the other children that rode on him in the London Zoo. P.T. Barnum of Barnum and Bailey Circuses eventually bought Jumbo. It was in international news when Jumbo was brought to America and made his debut in Madison Square Garden. And toured the country with the circus for 3 or 4 years and was the star of the show everywhere he went. In fact, Jumbo is a Swahili word. We get the word jumbo in English, meaning very big, from Jumbo the Elephant. He made a word. Sadly, Jumbo met his untimely demise in a train accident, but Barnum stuffed his hide and the hide went on tour for years. And eventually, people started to lose interest in that, and there was a fight over who's going to get Jumbo's hide between the Smithsonian, the Museum of Natural History, and Tufts won. And Jumbo's hide was on display here until the Barnum Museum burnt down in 1975. Jumbo could not catch a break. But one thing that you may not know, that I thought it was an urban legend, but it's true, is that Jumbo's ashes were collected in the aftermath of that fire and stored, most fittingly, in a peanut butter jar. I promised a surprise guest, ladies and gentlemen, so I'm very pleased to introduce my first guest for the evening. Please make some noise for the ashes of Jumbo the Elephant. Just one button. On the Sporkful podcast, we often discuss and debate questions of eating and their implications for society at large. How can resources like the melted cheese and nachos be distributed equitably? When you enter into the social contract of a potluck dinner, what freedoms are you giving up, and what are you getting? And what are the ethics of cherry-picking specific ingredients from a snack mix? The great philosophers have debated these questions for centuries. Joining me now to continue the dialogue is a professor of political theory here at Tufts. He's won the university's Leibniz Prize and the Unite Award for Excellence in Teaching, and he was my college advisor. Please welcome Professor Rob Devigne. Thanks for coming, Rob.
Just checking, looking for the emergency exits.
I'll fix this for you. There you go. Is that better?
Oh, yeah, it's great.
All right. So, can we just reminisce a little bit to start here? There are so many stories that you would tell in the process of teaching that really stuck with me. I remember you would talk about your neighbor who was always outside fixing his house, and you referred to him as Joe House. How is Joe House?
Joe is well. We moved from that house, but I hear we exchanged cards in the holidays. So okay. he seems to be doing well. Joe fits in your book with the person who stays at the lower part of the hierarchy of ends.
Right.
He's just concerned about his house.
I see. And one of the things that you said that always stuck with me that I've related to so many different things, you know, in life. You said, I'm paraphrasing you, but that if you want your daughter to learn to play the piano, you could give her lessons and she could learn Beethoven and Bach. But if you really want her to be the most innovative pianist, you should really just give her a piano. Which did you end up doing?
Well, she's in the military now.
Really? What's she doing there?
She's in the military. Well, she's in there.
Top secret. Okay, gotcha. Understood. But it's amazing to me that so many things, I took your class, Western Political Thought, first semester freshman year, right. Which is...
I almost brought the midterm, just like you had your tapes. That would have been interesting.
Yeah. That was 20 years ago that I was in your class, my first semester freshman year, and I still remember so many parts of it so vividly. Is that something that you're cognizant of when you're preparing a lecture, when you're giving a class? It's like, is it weird to you to think that how do you feel about the idea that anything you say off the cuff could be something that some student is going to repeat back to you 20 years later?
I get requests all the time about stories, you know, especially, I don't know if you remember the Timmy the Rabbit story, but there was, people still write me 20 years later wanting to know what happened. It's a long story, you don't want me to get into it.
But how do you feel about that?
Well, I like to think that it's more that it's not just a random story, it's because it tries to resonate with the material that we're studying. So hopefully it kicks in with what you're studying and around some type of issue that's addressing, you know, the meaning of life, the meaning of human existence, potluck dinners, things such as that.
Right. Because I remember, you know, calling my parents and being like, I had this amazing class, this guy was talking about Pulp Fiction and Aristotle, it was crazy, you know. So I want to say thank you, first of all, for all the great classes that I took with you and for giving me material that I was able to turn into a book 20 years later.
That's great. You were a great student. I always had a lot of fun with you.
Oh, thank you. Like the time that you said, I want to pick on someone from New Jersey, and you called
They're
on me.
Easy to pick on.
And you said, where are you from? And I said, Upper Saddle River. And you said, isn't that where Nixon's from? And I said, no, he's from Saddle River. And you said, oh, that's so New Jersey. So, let's get into the topic. Do you got any water?
I'm good.
You guys like the mini fridge I have up here? I wanted to feel like a dorm. Let's start off with talking about snack mix.
Right.
You have a snack mix arrayed before you with four or five different components, and let's say one person keeps picking out all the pretzels. What do you see as the argument against that behavior? And what philosopher do you most associate with that argument?
Well, I would say, first of all, that Thomas Hobbes would say that you're going to have a big problem if you're just going to let people pick out of the snack picks without having some type of higher authority that's going to determine at what point will people's safety be harmed. So Hobbes would be primarily making sure that nobody was going to get sick and that none of the food was going bad.
But I mean, wouldn't Hobbes just be like, hey, snack mix is nasty, brutish, and short?
As, when there's no higher sovereign, that's the reason for the higher sovereign,
oh.
The higher authority. With it. So again, he wrote a tremendous book. Okay, I just want to give it a plug.
Hobbes did?
Both of you.
Thank you.
Hobbes and Pashman.
That's going in the back of my next book. I'm sure the copies will fly off the shelves. thank you, anyway.
Sure. Rousseau would say, well, to get into, you know, you used to always, I remember your midterm, and you actually got Hobbes and Rousseau a little mixed up. And you know, so, Rousseau would have a social contract, and he would say, well, we all have to have some type of agreement as to how, what's going to be our general will. So Rousseau would say there would have to be a general agreement between cherry picking or keeping harmony. I'm using your...
Sure.
And if you violated the general will, the general will had the right to force you to be free. So the general will could literally make you spit up.
Wow. Or at the very least, prohibit you from eating further snack mix.
It responds more to actions that have been done, but it would originally prohibit you because that's what the general will would say, yeah.
What about freedom? I mean, you've written extensively about John Stuart Mill, who's written about individualism and liberty. What would Mill have said?
Mill would say you could eat whatever way you want as long as you're not harming someone else while doing so.
What if the other people at the party don't like pretzels?
They should have probably not entered the social contract. You should have the right to emigrate, so you could just get up and leave.
So you feel like, so what would you say is the argument that says cherry picking is okay, and what philosophers do you associate with that argument?
Well, I think you could turn to Nietzsche's argument that God is dead. So by God is dead, meaning all the traditional ways of eating are gone. What used to be breakfast, lunch, or dinner is now up in the air. And it could either lead to great creativity and entirely new foods, or it could be that we will sort of just fade in the context of the task and continue to act the way we did under God, and continue to act in a very passive way, and continue to sort of restrict how we eat.
Just so, because that's the way we're comfortable?
Yes, that's the way we've been trained. So now we do it even though we no longer
have
know
to.
Why we're doing it.
Right. So what point do you think we're at now in snack mix society?
No, your book is very timely. because we're in... As you point out, we're...
I'm sorry to interrupt you, Professor, but I do want to just explain for people who have not read my book that there is a Socratic dialogue in the book in which great philosophers throughout history meet in a room and debate the ethics of cherry-picking specific ingredients from a snack mix. And that section of my book in particular was inspired by my work in Professor Devigne's classes. So we'll link to that at sporkful.com if you haven't seen it. But anyway, go on, please.
I think as... You mentioned in other parts of the book, not just the Socratic dialogue part, we're in a period where it's not clear anymore what is breakfast, what is lunch, and what is dinner. And this is both an opportunity and a danger. It's the opportunity to create new worlds. It's also we might just sort of listlessly mix everything up so everything gets watered down.
Interesting. Well, I'm an optimist. I'm gonna choose to view it as an opportunity. And the argument that I make in the book, or I know Socrates makes it in my book, and he wins because he always wins Socratic dialogues. That's why they're named after him. And the argument that I try to make through him is that when you eat a snack mix, any individual snack mix is a representation of the one true mix, the great snack mix in the sky, which is what I would call the platonic ideal of snack mix. And whatever that platonic ideal is for you, your personal great snack mix in the sky. And while you may never get there, it is the quest that defines us all. And I believe that by cherry picking the closest that you can get to your ideal snack mix from the available ingredients, you are fulfilling your, you are imposing your will to power, and you are becoming, you are moving closer to the great snack mix in the sky. And I feel like it is every eater's right. And it's not that you're, like, it's not that one snack mix experience is not a discrete moment in time. It is part and parcel of a lifetime of snack mix consumption. What do you think?
A great lecture.
Do you think that, do you disagree, though? What's your personal opinion?
About snack mix?
About what I just said. About what I just said.
I think it's mainly right what you said, and I think he would side with those who are picking what they want to pick and eating what they want to eat. So I definitely agree with you about that. The only thing I hesitate about is that Socrates said that the self-examined life is the best life, and you never do anything without, unless you completely know it. So I'm just wondering as to whether Socrates really would have moved into action unless he knew everything about whatever he was picking out of the snack mix.
How could you know without trying it?
Well, that's been a big debate about Socrates. Was he, how much was he trying, or how much was he just trying to let everybody else who was trying know that they were stupid?
Right. So he was a bit of an armchair quarterback.
Socrates says yes. That's the charge against him. Yes, one of the charges against him.
Okay. And do you cherry pick ingredients from a snack mix? You personally, when you're at a party?
Yeah, I'm a cherry picker. I don't like balance at all.
Let's talk just a little bit about potluck dinners, which I think are a type of social contract. You are giving up certain freedoms when you go to a potluck dinner. You're giving up the freedom to choose all the dishes that are going to be available in exchange for the freedom to bring something, to pick one of the dishes, and the freedom to not have to make the whole meal. Is that a fair... Am I using social contract correctly?
Beautiful.
All right, that was the right answer.
Beautiful.
Good. Because the rest of this segment would not have gone well if you hadn't... Thank you. Why do some social contracts succeed and others fail?
It depends on the level of agreement and how much does that agreement balance self-interest and the common good.
Okay. Because I feel that the social contract of potluck dinners is failing. 4/7 of the word potluck is luck. And yet, all too often, people say, I'm having a potluck dinner. They say, I'm having a potluck dinner, and then they tell you what to bring. Mm. That's not a potluck. And I think that when you reach potluck greatness, it's when you truly leave it to chance. You say, it's a potluck, bring whatever you want. And yes, sometimes you end up with 8 apple pies. But when it comes together, it's more magical because everyone has put themselves out there more. It's more of a leap of faith. So the risk is higher, but the reward is higher. What's your take?
Hey, you're on your game. That's good.
What would Rousseau think of that?
Rousseau, again, would say that you come to an agreement. Yeah, if you came to an agreement that we should all bring something, then everybody should bring something, okay? And then you sort of have to live with what gets brought. So there's no guarantee that it's going to work out. I think Rousseau would fit in with that nicely.
All right. That's good. And what's your personal opinion? If you get invited to a potluck, what do you bring?
A bottle of wine.
How do you deal with free riders at a potluck? People who show up with,
Yeah, I don't like it when people are mean to me.
But how would Rousseau suggest that we deal with people who show up at a potluck dinner and don't pull their weight?
They should be punished. or thrown out.
Interesting. All right. Well, I want to thank you again, okay. Professor Devigne, for being such a great teacher and advisor, and for joining me here today. A big hand for Tufts' own Professor Rob Devigne.
Thank you to him. Thank you, Dan. Great job. Thank you.
All right, I'm going to stand up now and move to the side because it's time for some more musical entertainment. And I am very, very excited for this next group that's going to be joining us. They are, well, all right, we're going to talk a little more in a minute about Bhangra music and dance. But rather than tell you what it is, I would rather show you what it is. And the best way to show you is by welcoming the Tufts Bhangra team, which is one of the best Bhangra teams in the entire country. We're very lucky to have such a kick-ass Bhangra team right here at Tufts. So please make some noise for Tufts Bhangra.
Let's hear it for Tufts Bhangra!
That's Bhangra. Or Bhangra is actually the more correct way. Sorry, I'm working on my pronunciation.
All right.
Those of you who are into club music probably know who DJ Rekha is. Those of you who are into South Asian culture probably know who DJ Rekha is. But for the benefit of everyone else, DJ Rekha put Bhangra music on the map in America in 1997 when she launched an event in New York called Basement Bhangra. The New York Times has called her the ambassador of Bhangra. And thanks to her work not only in music but also as an educator and cultural ambassador, she was named one of the most influential South Asians by Newsweek. She's been featured by the Smithsonian, NPR, CNN, PBS, and more, and she's performed at a place you might have heard of called the White House. But tonight she's not slumming it at some second-rate venue like that. She came all the way from New York to be here with us. Please make some noise for the one and only DJ Rekha.
Check, check.
What's that?
Just checking the mic.
Oh, well, you know how to use one of these, don't you? So, what's the correct greeting on Diwali? Wait, I'm sorry. Skip back. So, Rekha, we meet here. We're approaching the Hindu holiday of Diwali. Mm-hmm. What is the correct greeting on Diwali?
Happy Diwali. Diwali Happy. Mubarak.
What is that? Some weird Hindu word? Happy?
Hindi word.
Hindi. Sorry.
I would say the proper greeting would be Diwali Mubarak, which means good luck.
I thought that
but
was
people do say Happy Diwali.
Okay, is there Shubh Diwali?
Shubh Diwali. Okay.
Okay. And I'm teaching you now. This is a bad. This is.
That wasn't in the Wikipedia thing I just read.
Can you give me the quick explanation of what Diwali is?
Sure, I'll give you the quick explanation as I know it. Diwali is a holiday celebrated not only by Hindus, by Sikhs, Jains, and Buddhists. It's essentially a harvest celebration. It's around a full moon in the harvest time. So like many areas of the world to celebrate spring harvest, this is basically a fall harvest. And different regions of South Asia attribute it to different religious stories. So North Indians use it as a celebration of when this one particular god was returned from exile and they had lights on for him, and different regions have different stories associated with it. But essentially, it's a time to celebrate prosperity. It's a renewal. People clean their houses. It's a festive holiday.
It's known as the Festival of Lights.
That's right.
Right. Have you had to fight the Jews? Has anyone trademarked that yet? Because we have a Festival of Lights too, you know.
Yeah, I know. It's not the same time period, but yeah, there's enough to go around.
Okay, all right.
We do have a parking suspended in New York City, so.
Oh, well, that's.
We have one day. There are many Jewish holidays that have many days suspended, so we're getting there.
Well, I'm pulling for you guys to get a few more parking holidays. How do you celebrate Diwali with your family?
How do we celebrate? Well, we light the house up all day and add extra lights and. IKEA is very happy with us because Indians all over the world are buying tea lights. So we light the house up. We have a puja, a little religious ceremony, where my parents attempt to sing every year. They fight over what line to sing. Me and my sister just kind of lip sync and nod along.
Right.
Then we have a little bit of Diwali sweets. If my dad is in a good mood, he gives us money. And then we play cards.
And do you guys drink anything?
Yeah, we drink scotch.
Okay.
Me and my father like to drink scotch.
Nice. This is the kind of holiday I can get behind.
Yeah. So we the key component for Diwali is, you know, Hinduism is arguably a religion, a philosophy more than a religion, so everybody celebrates it differently. My family is from North India. We are Punjabi. So It is very important in business families. They celebrate the goddess Lakshmi, which is the goddess of prosperity. So in the spirit of prosperity, we gamble. So it's a family affair.
That's not always so prosperous.
When you win, it is. Well, and often there are Diwali parties. My parents are very social, so sometimes I have one at my house with my friends, too.
Right.
And, yeah, it's a good time. And we used to be able to stay up late before and go to school late the next day.
So okay. Well, we're here on a college campus. I have a mini fridge here because I wanted us to feel like we were a little bit like in a dorm room here on campus. And I'm going to open up the fridge, and I got some surprises for you in here, Rekha.
Oh, yeah.
First.
Thank you.
There you go. There's a glass. And I'm going to wonder what's in the freezer compartment of the mini fridge.
Oh, yeah.
Oh. Hey, send that glass over this way.
All right.
Say when.
When.
Let's get some sound effects here. Oh, we'll add that in post. All right, let me seal this up so I don't spill.
Your glass is a lot bigger than mine.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Mm.
I was right.
I can get this is a holiday I can get behind.
Yes, it's my favorite holiday.
Let's look in the fridge and see what else we got. We got Indian sweets. Mm-hmm. Now we got a little bit of a showdown here. We have the sweets that were purchased in Cambridge, Massachusetts at a sweet shop. And we have the sweets that you brought from Queens. Thank you so much for bringing these. You're already ahead because yours came in a much more beautiful package.
I think it's taped down to make it easy to get to.
So let's snack on these. Oh, this looks so good. Oh, let's take a bite before we do anything else. Here you go. Take your pick.
Okay.
So what? There are green ones and white ones. They're sort of rectangles. Mm-hmm. What are we eating? Tell me about it.
So what we're eating is barfi. B-A-R-F-I. It's essentially cheese. Literally, it's a milk concoction, solidified, and there's two kinds there. One is plain barfi, and the green one is pistachio.
Mm.
And on top of it is silver. It's actual silver.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Like prosperity.
Yeah. So.
This is really good.
In Diwali, often with the sweet offerings, there's often a lot of different kinds of sweets. People try to outdo each other. The boxes are more. Elaborate every year, people gift them to people, but I prefer to go back to the basics. The plain burfi is my favorite, second to the pista burfi, the pistachio flavor.
Well, it's really good. It's kind of like a cheesecake filling, but a little bit sort of denser and with a little bit more texture to it, which I really, it's not quite so creamy, it's a little drier, but it is delicious.
It takes hours to make the thing before it solidifies.
Yeah, we'll talk more Diwali in a little bit, but let's talk a bit about some of the foods you like to eat when you were growing up. Tell me about growing up. I know you were born in England, but you grew up in Queens, right?
Queens and Long Island.
And Long Island. And so Long Island.
Yeah. Strong Island, anyone? Yeah. All right.
Tell me about like what kind of food you guys eat growing up in your house.
So we had, every night, my mom, I don't know how she managed to do it, we had a fresh Indian meal. Fresh rotis, which is the unleavened bread, mostly vegetarian, one lentil, one vegetable dish, and often just chicken a few times a week. Every night for dinner was the same thing. After school, we ate every processed American food imaginable. Chef Boyardee's, TV dinners.
Why was that? Your parents weren't, your mom was working?
Latchkey kids.
Okay.
Our school let out really early. We ate dinner really late. We ate dinner around 9:30, 10 o'clock at night. My dad had a business. He came home at 8. He needed to chill. Then we had dinner. So that was, I didn't really experience American food properly until I was older and adult. We didn't really go out to restaurants much. Except, of course, Pizza Hut, because it's vegetarian.
And so, what were some of your favorite Indian staples growing up?
Well, I was kind of, I wasn't so into Indian food growing up because I felt like I was forced to eat it, but I came around and now it's my favorite food in the world. I love rice, chicken and rice. I love chicken and rice in any culture.
Right.
So that was my favorite. On Sundays for brunch, my mom would make stuffed parathas, which is the bread stuffed with different fillings. So she'd make it, her specialty was alu. So it's potato filling,
oh, yeah.
spices, and you eat it with yogurt or butter.
And how would you do the flat, how do you combine the yogurt and the flatbread?
It's just sort of a dip.
So you break it up with your hands and dip it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And what would be your ideal ratio of paratha to yogurt? How much yogurt do you want in a bite?
You want enough. You don't want to overpower it.
Mm-hmm. You want mostly to taste the paratha.
You want to taste the paratha. But the ideal way is to do a little butter, a little yogurt, and then that's the way I like it.
Right.
And
butter or ghee?
Butter.
Oh.
Butter. You could put ghee on top. I'm not a big fan of ghee. I like actual butter.
Okay.
I know. I'm gonna get kicked out of the
club. No, seriously.
Drinking on Diwali, and yeah. I hate ghee.
Yeah. And what was your favorite American processed food?
My favorite American processed food. This is the first time I'm ever sharing it. I really like chunky sirloin burger soup.
From a can.
They had grill marks on the burgers.
They're probably like painted on by child laborers.
I don't know. I have a real like. I like spicy food and Indian food, but I also like really like meat and potatoes, banal. You know, some things that's just like kind of salty. I guess I would say I have the meat tooth. So in addition to eating, not the sweet tooth. In addition to eating regular food at home, like Indian food, at parties there was always a bigger spread. So at parties there was always more variety of meat, kebabs, many, many dishes. So I like that food a lot. I love dried meat, like kebabs and things. Sorry. Okay, sure.
Yeah, I hear you really like kebabs. Like, really like kebabs.
I do.
Is it true that your nickname as a child was Kebab?
How did you find that out?
We're breaking all the news on DJ Rekha here tonight.
In my 20s, my friends nicknamed me Kebab.
That's now, Rekha, you are certainly more knowledgeable about the music scene than I am, but it's my understanding that a lot of popular DJs, over time, they change their name. You know, they're like Puff Daddy was P. Diddy, and then Diddy and Puffy, or whatever the order was. I lost track. Do you think it might be time for DJ Rekha to become Kebab?
I never thought of that, but you could be onto something.
There you go. You are going to sell out twice the size of the clubs now.
That's right. Thanks.
And take away the DJ, just Kebab.
Just Kebab.
Yeah.
There'll be some great expectations on the dance floor. There'll be food served with the event.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Well, you can have that's free. That's for you.
Great.
One of the things that is interesting to me about eating Indian food is that you often have a lot of different components in a spread. Mm-hmm. You know, you're not just eating one thing. There's a bunch of stuff on the table. Mm-hmm. And there's often some breads, and maybe there's also rice, and if there's meat, but there's so much going on. There are so many ways to combine it and so many bites that can be composed. Walk me through like one of your ideal bites of Indian food. How do you compose the bite? What's in it? Like, nerd out here with me for a minute.
Okay. My ideal bite is, it's the question between the bread versus the rice.
Mm.
And how to do it. Some people eat the rice as its own thing and then eat the bread separately. I actually like to, if there's fresh bread there, I like to mix in the rice with the different ingredients, whether it's like a vegetable or a meat, and then take the bread and put the rice and the bread together and make that my bite. That's the ideal bite for
Interesting.
Me. And then dip it in some yogurt.
Is there some kind of a mortar that adheres the rice to the bread? Do you get some dal in there?
You just kind of scoop it.
You make the bread into a scoop. Yeah.
One of the things you learn as a kid is how to break the bread with one hand.
Whoa.
Yeah, advanced skills.
Well, I mean, traditionally, many Indian people eat with their hands all the time. It's very common, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah, it is.
And I know that I have Indian friends whose grandparents say it doesn't taste right if it's not with their hands.
Right. I didn't grow up in that household. We did grow up eating rice with spoons, and then as an adult, I started eating it with a fork, and now I actually use a spork.
Awesome, a spork.
Yes.
Man, if we could get this going on the subcontinent.
Yeah, it's ideal. You need a little bit of the tines to grab, you know, to get some texture, to grab things, but you really want to get the most amount of rice in each bite.
Well, you're 100% right, Rekha, and I fight with my wife about this, because whenever we have rice, she wants a fork with her rice. It makes no sense. Like, the shape of a piece of rice is exactly perfectly engineered to fall between the tines of your fork. Why would anyone eat rice with a fork? It makes no sense.
Yeah, but you need the fork to grit the meat, so.
Right. You need a spork.
You need a spork.
Okay. Let's talk a bit about sort of the place of Indian culture in America today. Well, all right, that sounds like a really pretentious introduction to this topic. Let's try to bring it down a notch. You kind of grew up between two cultures.
Mm-hmm.
How do you feel about that?
I feel blessed. I think it was great. I was very lucky. I think I grew up in between many cultures. Suburban, urban, Indian, non-Indian. I grew up in a predominantly African-American community, African-American Caribbean community, so that's another culture. I've spent a lot of my adult life in the Brooklyn culture, so there are many cultures.
But it's got to be hard at times, too. I mean, do you ever, like, I'm sure at times growing up, you felt like you didn't belong exactly in any one place. Like, you've said in the past that at times you felt like an outsider. Is that fair to say?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's typical. I mean, especially if you're in an immigrant household, you feel like you're not doing what other people are doing in the same way, or your parents don't value things that, you know, things like vacations, or like famously Asian sleepovers, or, you know, things like that.
So, Asians don't have sleepovers?
No. Why would you go to somebody else's house to sleep? Or camping? Why would you go willingly out into the woods when you have a house? Like, it makes no sense. You did not come to this country to then go and not be sheltered, right. Free of choice.
When you first started getting into music and working as a DJ, what did your parents think?
I mean, originally I worked with my male cousins, so they didn't think much of it. It's when I, took longer and longer to graduate college and had fewer and fewer day jobs that they started getting concerned. So, they weren't. I mean, I think, like with any parents, you know, most parents want economic stability. So they weren't too pleased. And I definitely lied a little bit when I quit my last job. I once met my dad in a business suit for lunch because he thought I was taking a lunch break and I had already quit my job. But I mean, it took a while. I mean, still, sometimes they're like, "When are you gonna get a job?" This is my job.
Right. But, I mean, yes, I get it. Mm-hmm. All parents want economic stability for their kids.
Right.
But you were blazing an especially unorthodox trail. I mean, not only being Indian American, mm-hmm. but also being a woman.
Right.
What was it like breaking into the music scene as a woman, and how did that contribute to your parents' reservations?
I mean, I think that... I don't think they really understood exactly. I mean, part of what I do is cultural, and I think that gives me a little bit of like license because it's promoting culture. So I think that's something I've always like, you know, that's been positive, in that it promotes culture.
Gives you license in what sense?
I mean,
sense?
It just gives me a pass, a slight bit of a pass.
Like as a woman, or just as.
Just as like working in the job where you're at nightclubs around drunk people all the time.
I see.
So I think that's something that they were, you know, it's also like, you know, you're always campaigning with your parents to prove that what you're doing is legitimate. So if there's any kind of success, you're touting it a lot. And I think that, I've been very fortunate in my career to have some great successes and some recognition in the media and stuff, and so it's been good. No, I mean, you know, they didn't like it. I think the other thing that is very common amongst immigrant children is like, you know, we kind of downplay what we're really doing just to sort of like cover it up, you know? So it's like, yeah, I'm just kind of doing this on the side or whatever, until, you know, you kind of reveal the truth.
Because like I think that it's interesting that you grew up, as you've said, like to some extent feeling like an outsider.
Mm-hmm.
But yet when it came time to sort of choose to forge your path in life, you chose to kind of remain an outsider? Like you could have gone into a path that would have felt more traditional and would have felt, made you feel, you know, would have been more the obvious path, and instead you sort of like blazed a new trail. I think that's awesome, but I think it's interesting that like you grew up that way, and it's like, do you think that that made an impression on you, or were you just a rebel from the beginning?
I think that my path has been organic, so it hasn't, there's not been no master plan. I'm not, when you're in it, you don't think you're blazing a trail, you're doing anything. It was kind of like, okay, I got this opportunity, I'm gonna start this party. I got some gear, I'm gonna do some gigs. When one gig leads to another gig leads to another gig, and next thing you know, it's 18 years of Basement Bhangra. Like, I don't think I actually foresaw that this would be my life's work. I also think that I come from an entrepreneurial business family. So when it's couched in that way, I think it has also like a little bit more value. And you know, I think my parents understood I was creative. So I think they did appreciate that side of it. And you know, in terms of being an outsider, I was also an outsider, but I was also, I mean, a happy native informant. I like my culture. I was always happy to explain and talk about it. So something about doing this work felt natural to me. So, and I like music. I was the kid with the Walkman on all the time. I was always listening to music, taping the radio, pause tapes. So, I mean, I couldn't have foreseen that this would be my life, but this is what it is. And so much of that was not only about the Indian culture, but it was about growing up at the right time when hip-hop was emerging, when electronic dance music, you know, what they call it now, and listening to New Wave, all those influences inform, you know, my mindset as a DJ. And I think part of that is growing up in New York.
And what do you think, this is sort of the last question on this general topic, but I'm sure. Curious. I was talking to an Indian chef, mm-hmm. Indian American, born and raised, but from an Indian family, mm-hmm. chef. And she was expressing frustration that she's working on a cookbook and the publisher feels like they're not sure how to sell the book, they don't know how to explain it to people, they want to sort of pigeonhole her. Mm-hmm. And I can respect that that could be frustrating on one hand, but then I also feel like Indian food has made tremendous strides towards the mainstream, and these things just take time. How do you feel about Indian food, the place that it's at right now, in the larger context of like American food and culture?
I think it has a long way to go. I think people still think, don't really know what the details of Indian food are. I think the details, it's like, they might know it's hot, or they might use the word curry, which we know doesn't really mean anything. It's a generic word, but I'm not sure they really know. If you could ask somebody, name an Indian dish, or name something specific, I'm not sure people really know what those things are. I think in New York, everyone knows chicken and rice, which is arguably Indian or not, and I think most urban cities have Indian restaurants, but I think there's still a lot of room to explore Indian food.
And how do you feel about that situation?
I mean, it'll take time, but it'll find its way.
But it's not like a source of frustration to you?
That people don't know more about Indian food?
Right.
No. I mean, you know, everybody gets there when they get there.
All right, fair enough. Well, I want to bring it back to Diwali.
Yes.
Now, should we try a few more Central Square? These are the sweets from Central Square here in Cambridge. And let's bring on now, we're going to do sort of Diwali lightning round now before we wrap up. Two members of Tufts Bhangra, Naya Nika and Saruj. Come on up here, guys. You guys can stand right at these mics. Rekha, why don't you pass them some sweets?
Sure. Oh my gosh, is this trivia for us?
Trivia, it's more like there's not really a right or wrong
answer.
The recipe
for each item.
Yeah. Unless Rekha says you're wrong, then you're wrong. can you guys each tell me what your favorite sweets are on Diwali?
Sure. So my favorite sweet is laddu. So I grew up eating my grandmother's laddu, and she is from India, and this is my paternal grandmother. So whenever I went back to India, she would always make these handmade, and I can say by far that they were the best laddus I've ever had. Like, store-bought can never compare, and every time we visit or someone from India is coming to back to the U.S. from India, she always sends, like, this huge crate and, like, makes my day.
And can you tell me what that is? I'm sorry.
Yeah, totally. So this like ball-like thing. So the way they make it is that they basically take dough and then fry really small balls. So there's like a paddle that has holes in it, and you basically like pour the dough into that paddle so that the small balls...
Like a sieve.
Yeah, a okay. sieve. And then it goes into like boiling oil so that they fry. And then after they fry, they put it into a lot of sugar, like syrup basically, and then you compress them into balls.
Whoa.
Yeah. It's an art.
Is there, are there lentils in... this is my ignorance. Are there lentils or anything, or is it just dough?
I'm not sure what...
I'm going to try one. Made, this reminds... It's like a miniature version of a dish that my wife's grandmother makes, which is also... In America, they just call it monkey bread. She does the Hungarian thing called arangalushka, but it's like... imagine you just took a bunch of, like, munchkins and put them, press them into a bundt cake pan and like, turn it and cook it as a cake. This is like a miniature version of that. I'm going to try one. Can I try one? Suruj, what's your favorite?
It's actually pronounced Suraj. Sorry, just want to get that.
Go on.
I love gajagatri. So it's a triangle. It's made of cashew and sugar. I have a huge sweet tooth, so I love any kind of Indian sweet. Yeah, it's actually in this box too. It's this.
Yeah, take one. Tell me how this one rates.
Sorry?
I said, go ahead and take one.
Oh yeah.
Tell me how it is. Tell me what you think.
Can I take my?
It's deep in there.
Yeah, please. Yes, yes. Oh, eat. I'd offer you whiskey, but I'd have to card you first. My favorite, as someone who's only ever had a few Indian sweets, I love these...
Gulab jamuns.
Mm. Are these gulab jamuns?
Well, they're gulab jamun sandwiches. So.
I thought they were called chum chums or something. That's something
the
different.
The chum chums are the pink...
The pink ones,
are,
okay.
Yeah, these are... they're similar shaped. This is a gulab jamun like a sandwich. So in the middle is rubbery, which is the... Similar to what the burfi consists of.
It's like the cheesecake filling,
yeah.
But it's like a cake
right.
that's been soaked in syrup.
Right, chum-chums are much softer, and they're often pink.
Oh, man.
So the thing about laddus also is they're used in lieu of cigars. They're festive, so if someone has a baby or something, or if there's something, an occasion, people give them out, right?
Mm-hmm. Gulab jamuns are my jam. These things are so
they're
good.
They're also known in short as GJs. Indians love abbreviations.
Yeah. Rekha, what were your thoughts on the Bhangra performance that we saw?
It was excellent. It was great.
Thank
great
you.
Outfits. Thank you. Things have come a long way.
We got best costume at one of our competitions.
Yeah, there you go.
They're awesome.
No, it was fantastic. And the other thing about the kaju burfi is kaju means cashew, so that's made out of cashew.
Yeah. So. And do you... what's the one that's a little ball of fried balls?
Laddu.
Laddu. How do you, do you just bite into it or do you break it?
I bite into it. If I broke it, it'd just be like small balls.
How does this one rate? Is it as good as your grandma's? Is this one as good as your grandmother's?
Oh, not at all.
I'll bet when it's still warm, they are ridiculous.
Oh, yeah. Amazing. And then they're even better the next day when they're in the fridge, too, because like all the sugars kind of melted into the whole ball, and it's just the best thing ever.
Right. What are some of your guys' favorite memories from celebrating Diwali with your families?
My favorite memory, I can definitely by far say that the best Diwali I ever had was when I was actually fortunate enough to be in India at this time. So I was a lot younger, so I could take time off from school to be in India at this time of the year. And it was one of the most amazing things because the whole street is just completely lit up with a lot of lights. And then everyone's just doing the biggest firecrackers everywhere, like on your porch outside of your house. So it was a great experience. I think I was only 5 or 6, but I just remember it so, so clearly.
Right. And for me, so a few years ago, we had a big party with my family. And so having all my cousins from India, from California, all across the nation come to my house and just celebrate the whole week over there was the shit, yeah. Yeah.
And what was it about that that made it so great?
Just being together, because a lot of Diwali is just being with family, recalling memories together, meeting cousins for the first time, and coming together after being apart for such a long time. Just a great time to be with family and friends.
Rekha, do you have a special Diwali memory?
Yeah, when I won the most money at the card game. The card game we play is Teen Patti, which is a three-card poker.
Great game.
All right, well, once again, big hand for the members of Tufts Bhangra. And DJ Rekha, thank you so much for joining us. For more on DJ Rekha's work and her live shows, go to djrekha.com. Big hand for DJ Rekha. We have one more live guest and one more musical act and one more guest. But first, real quick, I want everyone to stand up. Come on, stand up. We need a little blood flow here. I'll do it too. Stand up. Stretch up high. Stretch your arms over your head.
Feels good, right?
Now jump up and down 3 times. You feel loose? Okay, you can sit down now. Time now for another musical performance. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Tufts' only co-ed Jewish a cappella group. Make some noise for Shir Appeal.
Mor bis akor bit di buchat Ich mi anuel, ich mi anuel am yuchat Hashem echad, ushmo echad Hashem uti peretz vini tila Likrat Shabbat מחוי מלאך כי מקור הברכה מנוש מקדם נסוחה סוף מעשה מחשבה תחילה לך דודי לקראת קלה פני שפעת נקבלה לך דודי Prat kala, pene shabbat nekabela. Lachadoti, prat kala, pene shabbat nekabela. Veyu, pleshim sashosai, ve'lachakuk komel alai, yasadai. Shabbat Malkita, Lachadodi, kabila hadodi likrat kala pineshabat nikabila hadodi likrat kala pineshabat nikabila.
Big hand for Shir Appeal. Let me get myself organized here. Oh, good, here, I got it. Okay, all right, I'm ready. I like that our dorm room setting is getting messier as the evening wears on. All right. Oh, two quick things. We need to record room tone. Everyone be quiet for 10 seconds. Ready, set, go. That's not quiet. Great. Other thing is that after the show, I'll be happy to like hang out a little bit if anyone wants to come say hello, like right just a few feet from here. Joining me now is a very talented and original comedian, as well as a former high school classmate of mine. He's a 2010 Last Comic Standing finalist. He's appeared on The Tonight Show with Conan O'Brien, The Late Show with David Letterman, Comedy Central Presents, and all the other places that he's been. Those are the places he's been. His latest comedy special is on Netflix. It's called Small, Dork, and Handsome. Please welcome Myq Kaplan.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Myq, it's great to see you.
It is great to be seen.
When I know now, people may know that you spell your first name M-Y-Q, Myq. But I knew you back when you spelled it M-I-K-E.
That's true.
Did you have it legally changed?
No, don't tell the police. A joke.
I have to question your commitment to your craft a little bit if you didn't go that far, Myq.
I'm not so committed to a silly thing that I made up when I was 14 that I would take legal action.
Right.
I changed it when Prince changed his name to a symbol, and I was like, that guy's weird, I'll be weird. And then at least I stuck with the alphabet, so by comparison, I'm just like a regular guy. I'm like you know? We all have letters in our names, right? And then he changed his back because it was like a legal dispute that he had a reason for it, and then I was like, oh, I guess I'm weird and alone now. But now it helps to Google me, so mostly I don't care, but if you like it, great. If you don't, I get it, right? Weird.
Well, because I don't know if you know the competitive eater Crazy Legs Conti.
I know nothing about that.
He had his name legally changed.
His name is now legally Crazy Legs?
Correct.
I would say that's crazy of legs to do that.
So it's the right name for him.
Absolutely. Yeah, I'd say, is it Crazy Legs the first name or is Legs the middle name?
That's a good question.
Thank you. I ask the tough questions here on your podcast.
That's right. You have a master's degree in linguistics.
Yes.
And I know that a lot of your humor is related to language, and I wanted to engage you on a little Sporkful-esque discussion here.
You may.
I am on record as saying that I do not believe that sparkling water is water.
Okay.
I believe that when you add CO2 to it, it ceases to become water. It ceases to be water.
Is there anything that you can add to water that would make it remain water?
If the water is H2O.
What about salt water? Is that water?
It's ocean water, which is a different type of water.
Type of what?
Ha, 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 ha. I think that when you add something consciously to it, what are you, Googling water on your phone?
Already did. here's the Wikipedia page for carbonated water, okay. Also known as club soda, soda water, sparkling water, seltzer water, or fizzy water, emphasis mine. Is water into which carbon dioxide gas under pressure has been dissolved. I did study linguistics, and we discussed, like, I had a class of semantics where we discussed, like, what is the meaning of a chair? And we talked about, like, what makes something a chair, like, as opposed to, like, say, a stool, because you have a chair that's very similar to a stool. You make it a little higher, oh, it's not a chair anymore. Or wait, it's a high chair. That's a higher chair. And you guys are familiar. And there's a bunch of babies in the audience. So, or like, if you make it longer, when does it become a bench? Or is it a couch or a love seat? Like, and there's obviously on the fringes of things, like there's, if you say, think of a chair, you would think of, most of us would think of a similar looking thing, sort of the prototypical chair, but you could have a beanbag chair, which we're also like, that's a chair, because it has the function of a chair.
Right.
And so you have the form and the function combined to make the thing. And definitely, the more things that you add to water, the farther away it gets from the prototypical water. Like you said, like ocean water, seawater, when we say, hey, do you want some water? And somebody says yes. If you handed them a glass of salt water, they'd be like, why did you do that?
Right.
Or if you gave them like super hot boiling water, be like, hey, this is not like the, you know, if you're like, here's some water, like drinking water is different. But I would say that carbonated water is still a type, it's not so far from water. Like if you were going to argue that tea isn't water, I'd be like, okay. But also it's like 90-something% water plus it had some stuff in it.
Then why aren't human beings water?
Fair question.
Thank you.
I mean, basically, there's one version of me that would have to continue to argue that human beings are, because of the percentage of water that we are, we're mostly water. But I do think
so. If I said, yeah, Myq, I want a glass of water, and you hand, and I...
I get into a cup and hand myself to you?
Right.
I don't see why you could have a problem with that. I'm water, drink me.
That would not quench my thirst.
No, it probably wouldn't. I do think that human beings are like 70-something% water. So I think that there is a number like beyond, what's like, here's the thing. If you have one grain of sand, that's not a pile of sand. If you have 1,000, that's a pile. But if you have, what number grain is it that you add that you can't, it's like a sort of a philosophical, like, you know, impossible to answer thing.
No, I have an answer. Yeah. As soon as one grain of sand is elevated off the ground by another grain of sand, you have a pile.
Okay, so similarly, I would say there is a percentage. Like if something's 99% water, then that's water. You know, you can have maybe 98, whatever, I don't know what the percentage is, but when it gets down to, it's really weird that we are, it's strange that we're 72% water, because also we're, you know, solid. I mean, it is ice water? I mean, ice water is water, but it's water with ice in it, and ice is also water. So, I'm not saying that I'm not going to tell anyone that they're wrong, but I think if your last name is water, like salt water, carbonated water, flavored water, then...
What if you're a misnomer? I mean, here's my point, Myq. If you're going to go at it with the approach of we must find a percentage point at which something ceases to be water.
I won't say must, but go on.
Okay, but if that's the path we're going to go down, you're going to have a big gray area, and you're never really going to know. There's always going to be very contentious issues, and these, you know, as you know, you are a lover of language, words matter. If you go with H2O, water is H2O, and if there's anything else in there besides two hydrogens and an oxygen, it has to be something that got there naturally, like a mineral that seeped into the water or some oil from some fracking, you know, like whatever just got there naturally.
So if there was naturally carbonated water, you'd be fine calling that water?
Yes.
And so you have two cups, otherwise indistinguishable, both with carbon in them.
No, the intent of the water must be to be H2O. The water must be striving to be pure H2O.
I don't like to use the word crazy too much because I don't think that that's, you know, it's not kind to people who have mental illnesses. But you are, I'm going to say being unreasonable. I think if there are, water doesn't have intent. I mean, unless you're saying that humans are water, in which case that kind of water does.
So water does have intent.
Wait, but now you're saying that humans are water.
Oh,
so,
damn it.
Yeah. And I didn't, look, this is natural. Like, human, look, 72% water, and it got there naturally. Who cares that it has a bunch of other elements in it? And a brain and such.
Let's move on, shall we?
Fair enough. So, who won?
By show, let's do an audience poll here. By applause, who here thinks that carbonated water, sparkling water, is water? All right, yeah, that's enough. Who here thinks that it is not water? All right, well, I got the rabbi. The rabbi clapped for me, so we'll call it a tie. All right.
And were there any scientists clapping for the first time? Science says yes, religion says no.
You were telling me that you have a friend who has thought deeply about the definition of pizza.
Yeah, college roommate of mine. He is a purist like you are for water, for pizza. Because I became, I think, vegetarian in college and then later vegan. And he was like, there's no such thing as vegan pizza because pizza, he says, has to have these three components. Like bread, you know, in the form of crust, tomato product, usually sauce, and cheese. And so to him, I was like, well, what about like a white pizza that doesn't have any tomato? He's like, nope, that's not pizza. I was like, what about like a cheeseless pizza? It doesn't even have to have vegan cheese. Like, nope, not a pizza. So to him, like a piece of bread with, you know, a piece of cheese and a tomato on, he's like, that is closer to a pizza. And so I'm like, that's like the U of pizza.
So is vegan cheese cheese?
I know there's like some debates going on with the issue of like mayo. I feel like
I should fill people in. So there's a company called Hampton Creek that has created a vegan mayo that has no eggs in it. It's called Just Mayo. It has a picture of an egg on the label, and I have gone on record. The FDA is giving them a hard time. The FDA is saying you can't call that mayo because mayo is eggs and oil. It has to have eggs and oil. And there's a fight going on. And I have said that I think that the FDA is right. I don't think, and I've had the Just Mayo, and it's very delicious. I'm not knocking it.
Oh, yeah. No, I understand. The idea is that, are they trying to put one over on people?
Right.
To trick people into thinking, like, hey, this is mayo, and it's good. And then they eat it, and you're like, ha-ha, it wasn't. It's actually better for you, and the environment, and animals. And you're like, damn it, I wanted to hurt things, you know? But here's the thing is, like, number one, language changes over time. Like, we're not speaking the same thing that Chaucer wrote in or Shakespeare. Like, Old English became Middle English, became Modern English. Like, here we are today. Like, words shift their meanings and their shapes. And, like, for example, milk means many things. Like, you know, there's soy milk, almond milk, rice milk. And nobody's like, hey, wait a minute, is this milk with rice in it? Like, nobody thinks that those, I mean, it'd be weird to think those things are from a cow and also, like, how did the almond, like, milking an almond, like, there's plenty of jokes about it. Like, that, you know, you just take the udders of the almond and then you get milk out of it. And so, I mean, we now understand that, like, milk means, it means, like, I mean, I think even, like, when they said that in the Bible, correct me if I'm wrong, Rabbi, when, like, I think the Jews were heading to Canaan, the land of milk and honey, like that wasn't literally, like, milk from a cow and honey that we think of today. Like, those, am I near right? I know nothing else about this. I only want it to be correct. but that, you know, the words, you know, words and meanings shift so that we understand that soy milk isn't a cow product. And similarly, like, if you go to a vegan restaurant, they might have, like, chicken on the menu or, you know, cheese on the menu, and everybody understands, like, given the context. And I think that ideally, probably the Just Mayo people would argue it, that their context was like, hey, we're just, like, it's a product that's like it. It's taking the function of it, so we're giving it the last name. Like, you know, there's things out there. I like cuter names. Like, there's, like, Neo. You know that? There's, like, Neonaise.
Right.
It's like mayonnaise, but it also has, like, the...
You like that better than Veganaise?
Yeah, I like, of the names, I like Neonaise better than Veganaise, because it's cute.
Okay.
I mean, look, if it tastes better, then I would eat it, but, you know, like...
In Russia, do they have Nietzsche's?
Do they?
I don't know, but it'd be great if they did.
I mean, that's not as, I'm not sure. I would like a fake lettuce called Nietzsche. Why are you making lettuce fake? We just, you know, Russia. In Russia, lettuce, anyway.
Yeah, I'm on the fence on the cheese one. That one I'm willing to cut you a little bit more slack because I feel like there's already so many different types of cheese to begin with. And like water is just H2O, but cheese, there's a bazillion different types of cheese already. So I feel like it's easier to throw a couple more on the pile.
And there's no standard for how, like, when you have a word, like a burger, you know, or a hamburger, or like, then people start saying, like, oh, turkey burger. Well, a hamburger wasn't a burger made of ham to begin with. It was named after Hamburg. And we're like, forget about that. Now, turkey burger. It's not a town called Turkeyburg and chicken burger. Like, then veggie burger. We understand it's now this burgers now just means the shape of the thing. It's made of whatever came before it. But then cheeseburger. That's not a burger made of cheese. Like, so just forget about it. You know what I mean? Like, just name things whatever you want. And so the like nut cheese, you're like, oh, it's cheese made out of, like, just look, just eat it.
What are some of the dumbest things people say to you when they hear that you're vegan?
I mean, here's the thing somebody said once. They were like, what if you found out that trees could feel? What would you do then? I was like, well, I guess I would just keep not eating trees. And they're like, wait. I'm like, you only get one wish. You know what I mean? I think that honestly, I think that a lot of people don't realize that I've thought about it a lot more than they have probably. Like, I'm not saying that I'm better than anyone. I'm not saying it, you know. But I don't know. Like, we're all, you know, just a bunch of water. And but a thing that people will say sometimes is like, you don't know what you're missing. I'm like, well, for about 20 years, I ate everything that you ate possibly, and now I've, for almost the next 20 years, been doing what I want because, like, not because I'm not, you can't eat everything. It's impossible for every person to eat everything as much. You can't maximize your experience. You can't date all the people. You can't read all the books. You can't eat all the food. You can't go to all the movies. Like, so if you're just talking about what you're missing, we're all missing billions of things. Like, we're always, you'll be so sad if you just focus on what you don't have. So I focus on what I do have and why I do want to do it. And I know that I did for years eat meat and dairy and like wasn't thinking that much about it. And then afterwards I was like, hey, here's why I don't want to do it. And here's what I will eat. And actually when I did eat meat and dairy, I mostly just ate like burgers and hot dogs and pasta and pizza, like, and garbage, you know, just like went through garbages and was like, hey, you threw out pizza? Wait, okay. And like then once I got to school, I went to college and there was like all these different vegetarian options and I'd never had like Ethiopian food or Cambodian food or Thai food or like even not that much Mexican food. And I was like, wow, there's lots of food. And like, did you guys know that? And honestly, like, I'll eat some fake meat things, but like even like vegan technology today, like vegan desserts, and like all these things like have vastly improved since like 10 years ago or 15 years ago when I first became vegan and I had like a vegan cheesecake and it was just like a piece of tofu and they're like, it's shaped like cheesecake, is that good? You're like, it's a triangle, do you like eating a triangle? You liked a triangle made out of cheese. But like now, if you go into any like, you know, upscale vegan restaurant, like their desserts, I actually brought some vegan cookies that my girlfriend baked. Oh. And I'll let you have one after the show.
I have had many wonderful experiences with vegan desserts in particular. I agree with you. I think that there's been great progress in the field of vegan desserts.
And I'll grant that maybe the maximal experience of eating cannot be attained by me, but also eating is a minimal fraction of everybody's day. Like, you know, it's something we do every day.
Well,
but,
all right, yeah. Slow down there, Myq.
I'm saying, right. Just it's by quantity.
By number of minutes, perhaps.
Yes.
But by mental energy devoted to thinking about it and pleasure derived from it, it's most of my life.
I understand.
but
let me suggest another way to be on this show based. You have a book and a whole career based around this myth and a lie.
But I am curious to hear, like, what part of becoming vegan has been surprising to you? Like, what did you not expect?
honestly, that it was so much easier than I expected. Like, I think I was like many people in high school, where I would, like, you know, eat a bunch of burgers, and, like, I ate at McDonald's every week, I ate at Blimpie's every week, and I was just, like, usually the same day, I'd get, like, it was just the same day they had a special on, like, foot-long subs for the price of a half foot, and, you know what they call it, hey, get a half-foot sub, and that's the only thing they've ever called it. I know how things go, I don't make mistakes, and the same day, there was a McDonald's right next, I just ate, you know, things that were tasty, but unhealthy. And I remember thinking, like, it would be great if I could, like, not kill animals. That was my main thing initially. But I was like, but I can't do that because they're delicious and I don't know how to live. And then, like, when I found out, oh, maybe I'll give it a shot. And then I was like, but vegan, oh, my God, to be vegan, you got to read everything and ask a lot of questions and be so annoying. And then I was like, wait, I'm good at all that. And, but I honestly felt like it would be more difficult, and, like, I feel like it could have been, like, people are like, isn't it hard eating on the road? And I'm like, well, you know, there's plenty of places that have, like, Asian restaurants. Every Asian restaurant has some vegan food. Every supermarket has a produce aisle. Every park has grass that you can graze on, you know? And, like, legitimately, like, wherever I go, like, the worst case scenario is, like, there's a Chipotle, which I enjoy, or, like, there's, you know, a sushi restaurant in Kansas, and you're like, where did you get fish? And I'm like, I'll just have the vegetables, thanks. And, like, we got those from the ocean as well. But just honestly, I mean, this I know that I'm answering the question in a way that you're like, what are your greatest strengths and weaknesses? I'm like, my greatest weakness is that I just have so many strengths, I can't pick one. You know what I mean? And you're like, what was challenging and weird and it was just so difficult, like, getting people to understand that my life is the best, you know? So that's an answer.
Well, I'm glad it's working so well for you.
So far, so good.
You made a web video where you got a 31-year-old guy to eat the first peanut butter and jelly sandwich of his life, and he almost threw up in the video because I guess he's a very picky eater.
This guy, I mean, he has, I think, some form of obsessive-compulsive disorder, which manifests maybe as a specific, I don't know if it has a different name, but up until the age of 25, I think, he had only eaten 5 types of food specifically, and it was like turkey, chicken, hot dog, and like 2 other, like, legitimately, he only had those 5 things because everything else was completely unpalatable to him. And he's like, I want to try and expand my palate. Maybe there are other things that I think are gross that aren't gross. And so he started a web series where he invited comedians that he liked a lot to, and he would say, I will try whatever you recommend to me. So he tried, you know, some people made him try, like, just things that they're like, hey, try this fruit, try this, you know, pasta, try this wine and cheese. And, like, a lot of the, some of the things he enjoyed, some of the things made him throw up, some comedians made him eat a pig's head. And, I think that was Bill Burr and Robert Kelly. And I was like, peanut butter and jelly. You haven't tried a peanut butter and jelly? And he like couldn't do it. It was just, he thought, I think he could take like one part of it. He tried the bread separate and the peanut butter and the jelly. And he was okay with like one of them, probably the bread.
How do you like your PB&J?
You know, growing up, I think my mom always made it, or like whoever made it for me would make it like wheat bread and grape jelly and peanut butter. Like crunchy peanut butter. I do enjoy crunchy peanut butter more than creamy peanut butter because look, there's more in it. Like you're getting a benefit, like a bonus from life. Like if you're just having creamy, then you have to eat peanuts separate. Like what are you doing? And I mean, but I understand. Like everybody has different preferences.
Do you like it with the peanut butter on the top or the bottom?
I haven't really thought about that. But also, let me say first, I actually like non-grape jelly the most now. Like, I thought that I didn't like strawberry jelly because I never had it. And, like, when you're a kid, you're like, I didn't have it, so I must not like it. But then I tried it, and I was like, why did my parents ruin this? You know? Like, why didn't you tell me? And, like, I mean, I like raspberry or, like, all these different, like, whatever different kinds of berries,
yeah,
or blueberries.
Yeah, I think are better. Like, jam is better than jelly in a PB&J. Anyway, it should be PB&Jelly.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
But
I do
like you're stalling.
Okay. I would say, like, when I make a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, I put the peanut butter on, if I'm going to put them on the same side, like, I think maybe ideally, I would put the peanut butter on one side and the jelly on the other, and I probably put the peanut butter on the bottom, but then I don't think it matters which way the sandwich goes. Please tell me that there's a reason I should think a different thing.
I'm so glad you asked. I actually would recommend thin layers of jelly on the top and bottom with peanut butter in the middle.
I guess I've never...
Yeah, that's right.
When I understand that, and I like that. So it's like a little... A sandwich with jelly bread inside the bread. It's like...
Yeah, because the problem is that with the peanut butter's on the top, it gets stuck to the roof of your mouth.
Mm.
If it's on the bottom, I find that it's still... Like, peanut butter is... It is sticky, and it gets all... You know, it gums up the works, you know, in the gums. It gums up the gums.
It works up your gums.
And gums your works.
Come on, guys. Why wasn't that great? You liked everything else. Yeah. Get on board with everything, even if you don't like it, involuntarily.
Yeah. When you put it in the middle, it goes down smoother, it's more chewable, you get the jelly rot on your tongue, a little bit of sweetness, you get the heft of the peanut butter, you get it all.
Is that more difficult to, like, imagine spreading peanut butter on top of jelly seems, like, weirder and, like, more difficult to clean the knife and,
Well, you lick the knife. Mm. And what do you fancy?
No, I lick knives all the time.
Okay. So that's how you do it.
Just in general. That's how I clean knives. Hope my girlfriend's not listening. We live together. Before I came out here, I actually read the Amazon page for your book, and one of the things it says you discuss is...
Thanks for prepping.
Absolutely. Yep. I care very deeply about this job that I have that's very silly. So there was part of it where it said maybe in the book you discuss whether if you have a cheeseburger, if it's better to have the cheese on top or bottom based on where your tongue is.
Yeah, cheese on the bottom, right.
And so is it in, like, when your tongue... Which part of the... Does that come into play here as well?
Oh, yes. So I feel like... I don't like my peanut butter and jelly to be too sweet. So that's why I like the jelly on the bottom, because it hits your tongue so you can consume less jelly but still taste more of it.
Oh, I like more jelly. I like sweeter things.
Well, it will taste as sweet.
Okay.
Without you eating as much sugar.
Oh, I do like that.
We got to wrap up here, Mike.
No, wait. Let me say how much more I like it. I like it a lot. Okay, ready to wrap up.
Myq Kaplan performs his wonderful brand of comedy all over the country. Check out his tour dates at mykkaplan.com. That's M-Y-Q. He also hosts a podcast called Hang Out With Me on the Keith and the Girl Network. And you can watch his latest stand-up special on Netflix now. It's called Small, Dork, and Handsome. Ladies and gentlemen, big hand for my friend Myq Kaplan. And now keep the applause going for the big finish. Please make sure you subscribe to this podcast on iTunes so you never miss an episode. Follow me on Twitter and Instagram at TheSporkful. This show's a production of WNYC and The Sporkful. It's produced by Ann Sani and me. Special thanks to Paula Schumann. And thank you to all the groups that made this network, all the groups that made this show possible. Tufts Hillel, the Tufts Culinary Society, the Tufts Podcast Network, and Tufts Alumni Boston. In particular, Lenny Goldstein, Shayna Burstyn, Stephanie Sanger-Miller, Allie Wainer, Cooper McKim, Sarah Gardner, Mark Sullivan, Jordan Rosenthal, Kay, Grant Fox, Eric Pappleton, Mike Justin, and Steve at Bay State Sound, and all of you. Until next time, I'm Dan Pashman, reminding you to eat more, eat better, and eat more better. Thank you.